Hey Potters, welcome to episode 220 of Cosplay! Woo!
You went so loud you broke the sound barrier.
Wheat. Kaboom!
It's episode 220. Yay!
I mean, I'll redo the intro if I need to redo the intro.
If you want to, it was just really funny how it cut off right at that moment.
I'll leave it as is just because it's, you know, funny.
It is funny, especially when I edit our year montage.
See, I went so loud, I actually looped all the way back around the volume knob and came around to the other side.
You did a full 360.
I turned it up to 11, dudes.
Oh, too funny.
Anyways, welcome to the podcast about all things cosplay and breaking the sound barrier.
We're very good at doing that.
Normally I don't, but I have been messing with some of my volume settings recently.
It's okay. It lends itself to funny moments like that.
Wave Rod, I always do that.
Oh yeah, that's what happened last time when you kept wooing the mic and kept cutting it out.
Yeah, but it's a pun and I'm answering it with the pun.
It's appropriate.
Yes. What I was going to answer is not, so I will just leave it there. And yes, apparently my computer is in fact self-censoring me. Anyways, why don't we get into what we've been doing cosplay for the last 2 weeks?
Yeah. Woo.
I did a soft woohoo.
You did a soft woohoo. Is it a pile of stuff?
It is a pile of stuff. It's always a pile of stuff.
I love how when I'm right, it makes me so happy.
Okay, what is it a pile of?
Is it going to be fabric? Is it foam? Is it Cintra?
You only get one guess.
Oh, well, that's not...
I don't have any Cintra. I only have Wonderflex.
Shoot. I only get one guess? I'm going to go with fabric. Hey! I win. Could be paper.
Actually, there is technically paper in here.
Pattern paper?
There is tissue paper. My poster, my butcher paper is on the table.
Paper can be a fabric.
Put it here. Yes, but it doesn't make a very good wearable one.
There's some cool stuff you can do with paper, yo.
Oddly enough, paper seems to get a little stronger if you wrinkle it and crinkle it up.
And yeah.
Then pull it out,
and then you pull it out.
Parchment.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Wish I could do that with tissue paper, but no, tissue paper tears when you look at it funny. Or if you sneeze.
You don't trust tissue paper. It's evil.
Yeah, but you know, it's what comes in an envelope.
I know. It's part of the pattern thing.
What comes with it. Anyways, I have been practicing tailoring before I touch my Athena fabric because it is very nice wedding satin and I only get one shot at it. This is not a measure twice, cut once sort of thing. This is more like a measure five times, cut once. Technically, the fabric is already cut out, but I know that I'm going to have to alter it anyway. Mostly because of my exercise regimen. So I am making a vest, which you can see here. Ah, I just dropped fabric.
Oh no!
I had leftover micro suede from Arwen way back in the day.
Mm-hmm.
Would make a nice dressy vest, and this is the one that I was on my soapbox complaining about darts last time. I did end up leaving the fabric the way it was. I did not add the dart. I'm probably going to regret that, but I messed with the muslin so much and just was not happy with any of it. Period. So we will see what happens. I may have to do something creative with this. But this will be the first time I've actually worked with facing. I've never made a faced garment before. For those who don't know, there is a difference between lining and facing. Go look it up. That's pretty much the only thing I've done. I have been sewing other things, just not cosplay things. And I've been crocheting some more. And I've been painting some more, and that's pretty much it. I've kind of hit a down period. Amber is having depression issues again, and it happens. Quarantine has not really been all that kind to my mental and emotional fortitude, so hopefully it will pick back up again soon.
It is what it is. It happens.
I gotta pick up the fabric I dropped. There we go. I didn't want to leave it on the floor because I have a rolly chair, and I know if I leave it there, I'm going to roll over it.
Maybe one of them will pick up the pin you're still missing.
It's not over here. It's over there.
Oh, well, shoot. Well, toss it over there.
Oh, toss the fabric over there?
Yeah.
Maybe how is that going to work any better than the magnet on a stick I waved over there?
I don't know. I'm just throwing out ideas.
In fact, not only did I wave the magnet with the stick over there, I also put the vacuum over there, still didn't find it, moved the entire unit over, disassembled it, and then took everything off of it, still didn't find it.
I'm sure it's long gone by now. It has vanished into the ether.
I sincerely hope that it is long gone. Because I still have this suspicion that when I go to move, I'm going to find it. And not in the way that I want to find it. Just because I'm best friends with Murphy.
Well, yeah. It's bound to happen. I think it's still going to be a situation where it is going to be on the day that you move out. But it's actually just going to be right there when you're least thinking about it. It's like, oh, there it is. Why did it take me 800 years to locate this?
I'm okay with this because I will, like, have the biggest smile on my face if I find it that way. That's the way it goes in my head. The scene from the movie where Amber finds the needle in a haystack.
Yes.
We'll see
brilliant.
If it actually goes that way. And, Carrie, I did take a super strong magnet. The magnets that I use are not the puny little things you find in the store. I ordered rare earth magnets.
She uses
from a local supplier.
Magnets. When she talks about magnets, she's talking about magnets. She's really good about it.
I have good solid neodymium magnets. In fact, technically, I think there are three of them on that stick at once.
So don't put that thing anywhere near a computer or...
No. No, I keep that thing pretty far away from all electronics, not just my computer.
Good plan. Very good plan. It's basically Amber's brave enough to use the magnets. I am not.
Allie, all of my lost socks are in the dryer because that's where lost socks go. And Wave Rod, once in my life when I was younger, I wanted to live forever because it meant that I would learn all the things. But over time, I've also come to learn that as you get older, you also acquire burdens.
Mm.
And I have decided that it's not worth all of the sadness and bad memories you'd also have to carry with you.
Right.
So maybe not so much 800 years.
Don't be a vampire, kids.
I'm not going to donate my brain to science and have them put it into a robot. No. Sorry, guys.
That is exactly...
When my time has come, my time has come.
That is exactly what my dad wants us to do.
This is like Futurama.
Basically, yeah. That's too funny.
Which is always the image I get in my head whenever I think of these things.
Exactly. Of course.
It's mandatory. Your turn.
Yay! So I have actually been working on a couple of things, shocking, that are cosplay related. Holy crap, what happened? I kind of got into this mood of going back through my closet and cleaning up some things, fixing some stuff, actually pulling things out that I haven't worn before and seeing like, okay, is there anything that I can do to kind of update them? And I'm actually going to start with a small tiny thing. This one is for my Ace Attorney cosplay. Cool little necklace that I actually purchased from a seller on Etsy and then did some lovely foam clay around it. Oh, I love foam clay. Oh my gosh. It practically added no weight to this thing. It's beautiful and brilliant. I love it. So yeah, it's for my Dahlia Hawthorne cosplay. Took like no time to do it. It was great. I think it took... Yeah, it definitely took way longer for it to dry than anything else because of the way the weather is being right now. Usually it takes about 24 hours for foam clay to dry, 48 hours for a hard cast before you start painting it. I gave it 2.5-ish days because the weather was kind of going this over the past couple of weeks. So yeah.
Welcome to Texas.
Exactly. I pulled my really big fancy Snow White costume out of the closet to fix up the back because my shape up top has changed once again. Lucky me. So I had to fix the back of it. I put in some new fastenings and I did more of a corsetry style in the back of it. So totally not at all replicating what it was supposed to be on the doll, but that's okay because the doll used Velcro. We're not using Velcro to keep this stuff holed up, kids, because that will not work. And then I decided for the heck of it to enter an online cosplay contest. Just for giggles. I don't know what possessed me. I was just read the rules and said, "Hey, okay, let's try it. We'll see what happens." So I don't know if it was accepted because they're not sending out confirmation emails. I don't know what the plan is. I don't know if they're going to show it because I had to do videotaping of it. That was entertaining. Or if it's just going to be kept amongst their staff members and they choose winners that way. I don't know. We'll see what happens. So if I find out more info, I'll post and you guys can go laugh at my terrible, terrible skit that I made in my Snow White costume. It is so bad. Oh, wait, do I have. Wait, hang on. I have the printouts over here. Hang on, hang on, hang on. It involves magical forest creatures. It's so bad and beautiful. It's great. So yeah, when I find out more info, I'll post that up because I just want people to experience the joy of my insanity. And let's see, other than that, I think that's caught up in all of my cosplay stuff. Oh, there's one more thing. I'm actually in the process of looking for a new dress form because my other one sucks. As I was in the process, it's true. While I was in the process of recording my video, I was using my dress form so I could do a fun quick change routine and it reminded me of how awful this dress form is. One of the components that actually keeps the dress form up on the pole has been broken since like month two of the purchase, and the manufacturer refuses to replace it for me. I've tried so many hacks to try to get this thing to stick up, but it really won't. Because eventually, over time, what happens is the dress form just starts to slowly sink down until it plummets to the ground. And I've tried everything to fix it and it won't fix. The only way to keep it up is I have to put it up the very tallest point of the pole, which comes with a couple of problems. One being it's so tall that I'm having to do this and I can't really see what I'm doing properly. The second part is because it's so up high, the center of gravity of it kind of tilts this way or this way or this way. So it's never on perfectly straight. It just kind of does this. So it's like, okay, I'm done. And I've kind of made the decision of I don't want to use any more of this dress form. And I don't need an adjustable dress form anymore. So I'm actually looking into like a professional dressmaker dress form. They're not cheap at all. They will probably cost me about $400 to $500, which is going to be very, very painful. But it's an investment and it's something that I've wanted for quite some time. And I keep thinking, okay, I could spend another 150 and get this exact same model. And that's three of the same model that I've purchased. And I could have just used that money to buy a professional one. So I'm just thinking it more of an investment piece. So I'm doing my research on dress forms. And if anybody has any suggestions on some good brands, let us know. Send us messages on Facebook. Or email us directly. Val wants to get a new dress form and she could use some suggestions, that's for sure. That's all I got. Yay!
My dress form has that sinking problem.
Yeah, and it's so funny because, like, it's the same brand that I bought last time. The problem with the last one is just wear and tear. I was pulling something onto it and then it kind of snapped something inside, and I was like, uh-oh, that was not a good sound. And it literally snapped the dress form in half. Whoopsie. The second one was fine for the first month, but then that second month is when it started doing the sliding problem, and it just got so bad that when I was recording my video, I just said, I need to buy a new one. This thing is stupid.
Mine has always done that and it is not broken. I think it's a design defect.
I think it is too. It just sucks. I want to work on it without it just going down on me. It's like, no, stay up. I can't sew like this.
So, for those having this problem, because I know that we are not the only people in the world that have had this problem,
Oh, right.
there's a couple different things you can try. depending on your dress form and what resources you have access to.
Mm-hmm.
And I put this to Val in the chat. You can try graphite, which is pencil lead.
Try that.
I'm saying this for the audience's benefit.
Mm-hmm.
That's the same stuff that violinists use on their pegs to make sure they don't slip.
Mm-hmm.
You can try Plastidip on part of the pole because that's meant to give it grip. Plastidip comes both in a can and a spray. I would probably use the can if you're going to dip the end of the dress form pole
right
into it. And if you only want to give it just a light coating for tensile purposes, just spray it really lightly. But the thing that will really fix it is pipe strap. Oddly enough, you set the poles to where you want them and you don't want them to move. And then right underneath the top portion of the pole that sits on the frame, I guess you'd call it, you put a pipe strap. And you tighten that sucker as far as it will go. You can do the same thing with a zip tie, but the pipe strap is removable.
Yeah.
Yay, Home Depot and Lowe's!
Right? It's a lot of having to hack it to keep it up, and it's just like...
Not literally hack it, because then you break it in half. But yes, you can...
I would do that anyways.
You can MacGyver different things.
Yeah, you kind of have to. And I was just like... It's just frustrating too, because it's like you spend the money for this thing to work and it ain't working. Like, why? Plus, the big problem I have, especially with the adjustable dress forms, is it seems like, particularly in the shoulders and the neck, they are way too wide for me and they are at the lowest level. I have nothing I can do to fix that. So I am constantly fighting with the measurements on that because it doesn't match here. So to actually have a dress form that fits me here, that would be, like, life-changing forever.
Well, I mean, they're made for average proportion.
Ever that means. I hate that.
You know, the day will come very, very, very quickly when we talked about being able to 3D scan your body and get custom patterns. You'll be able to do the same thing with dress.
Right. And you can buy a custom dress form. They're about $1,000. You know, but my concern always is your body's going to change shape over time. You could still get like those dress form pads, because that's essentially what I would have to do, is I have to buy a size down and then pad up in certain areas. So it's
you can always go out. You can't come back in.
So it's almost like, oh man, shoot. What? It's like, yeah, you can drop the money to do that, but if your body fluctuates in size every couple of months, that's $1,000 out the door. It's like, no, I don't want to do that. That's, mm-mm.
Yeah, well, women's bodies do this a lot, guys.
Unfortunately.
I don't know.
And it sucks.
You basically end up having to buy a dress form, like a full size too small.
Yep.
And keep it padded up so that if ever you shrink, then you just remove the padding.
Exactly.
But that's as far down as you can go.
That's exactly what I'm thinking of doing, is just like, instead of getting something that's really close to my size, is like, it's one down and then I can just pad up where I need to, because then I'm covered.
It's the opposite of what you do with patterns, which is to buy it one size too large and then cut it down.
We cut it down.
It's always easier to take it away from fabric, because you can't add fabric back on very easily.
No.
You have the opposite problem with a dress form.
Why must they make it this way? Why must it be so complicated?
Well, you know, I could give a really long answer to that, but I won't.
We know how that is. And it's really funny, too, because two of the websites I went to talked about how these were the standard size, but they also made a remark saying, we understand that that no one is a standard size. It's like, well... Thanks.
I don't think that's safe to repeat in our family-friendly show, so I won't, but thank you, chat.
And good thing I don't have chat going right now. Whee!
And also, as far as if you snap a dress form in half, can you use it as a skirt form and a shirt form? The answer is no. And the reason for that is twofold. One is because not everybody has equal top half and bottom half.
Yeah.
For one, I am one of those people. I have a short top half and a longer bottom half. But the second thing is because the lovely pole that goes up the middle of the dress form does not have a stopper at the top.
No.
So your skirt half would just slide down.
Just goes weep.
You could set the shirt half on top, but the bottom half doesn't have any sort of stopper on it, so it would just slide down its ring.
You'd almost have to keep the skirt half detached and just kind of hold it.
And you could only use it for skirts. You cannot use it for pants.
No.
Because of the pole.
Because of the dumb pole. Dress forms are great.
See, what they need to do is hang the dress form from the top.
Yeah, and they have a couple that are like that, that are just
because
like that.
Then you can use it for pants and it doesn't affect any of the other clothing that you put on it.
That would be nice if that was the standard, even if you didn't get the ones that actually had the legs on them. Like, just having that would be nice. And then you do the metal cage, which you can use to act as, like, your guide for, like, okay, here's where the hemline is. Like, that would be nice.
As long as it's an adjustable.
Yeah.
Like, the height would have to be adjustable so that you could work with hems of different lengths. Because otherwise you just get one leg.
It's whatever length it's on the floor.
Or however far that you told them to manufacture it above the floor. All right, you get 4 inches. That's it.
Yeah, the ones that are full body that actually hang like that, I think I've seen them for like $700 to $800 a pop. It's just like, my wallet.
That's the price of an entire cosplay, of a professional-grade cosplay.
Like, that's like 2-3 different cons for me because I'm so thoughtful about my money. And so I'm like, oh man, that hurts.
That's one A-con for me if I get a hotel room.
Yeah.
For all of the other cons, that's like 20 cons for me. I'm frugal.
You are. You're thoughtful and considerate about your money choices.
I'm going to need that money later when I have to retire.
Exactly. Whereas I go out of state and do stuff, so it costs me more.
You know, I'd love to be doing that right now or even to go out of country right now, but apparently, you know, the world is going nuts instead. And disease is running rampant, so I can't.
It's not a good plan, yo.
At least it's not a good idea to go around in an enclosed aluminum tube with a bunch of other people who may or may not be practicing good hygiene.
Right.
And then fly with them for, you know, 14 hours.
Not a good idea. We'll save that for another time.
Man, 2020 can just go in a dumpster.
Great cosplay updates.
AllCon is actually really inexpensive for us, Wavefront.
It really is. We're very efficient about it. Because it's local for us, too, that makes it much, much easier to get around and do what we need to do.
Yeah, since technically we kind of end up being like pseudo staff for the con, we have quite a bit more that is provided for us. And press, on the other hand, does not get anything except for a badge.
Yeah.
So when we go to other cons,
we got to pay for all of it.
We have to bring our own food too.
Yeah. All con, it's not necessarily this, it's mostly about that. It's a lot of time. That's how we pay. Yeah.
And all the money gets dumped into the contest.
Right.
We don't get any money.
No.
All of it goes to the contestants and the prizes.
We never see it. We make sure we spend every single penny. That's for sure. And it goes all to the contest.
Sometimes more than that, depending on whether or not we end up having to ship prizes.
Oh, that was some great shipping fees. Woo!
All right. So with that...
Yeah!
Would you like to introduce today's topic?
I will be happy to introduce today's topic. We're going to be doing another book review from one of the dozens and dozens of books that we got from the Humble Bundle recently. And this one in particular is focusing on the loveliness that is Cowbutt Crunchies and their extreme wig styling. So I hope that you guys enjoy this. Our next book review is the recently released The Art of Extreme Wig Styling by Regan, one half of Cowbutt Crunchy's cosplay. A creator that has been in the scene for quite some time and is known for their highly detailed costumes, unique designs, and super crazy cool wigs. This book was originally a Kickstarter project from October 2019 and first published in early 2020. I've been looking forward to reading this book and glad that I have a chance to do so. For those new to wig styling, your first glance at this book may have you feel a bit intimidated. There is a lot of text to digest, but it's to the reader's benefit. In viewing cosplay tutorial books over the years, one of my biggest complaints is sometimes the descriptions and explanations are light. You're not given the full information needed to properly understand the technique or the tools. The Art of Extreme Wig Styling is a great balance between descriptions and photos. You see the step-by-step process of working with a wig, alongside a detailed explanation of how to do the thing. In the introduction, it is explained that the teaching method is to step readers through the why this method of styling works and that there is no one right way. Experiment. Try new things. This mindset is seen throughout the book and helps the content be more approachable. Going into the different areas of the book, it starts with breaking down the aspects of a wig. The wig cap, netting, ear tab, and the rest. Even going into specifics on the difference in fibers, followed by a list of tools, their purposes, and why you need them. A big plus compared to other cosplay books in providing detailed information that can be beneficial to all cosplayers in understanding how wigs work. One aspect of this book I really like is you can read it in multiple ways. If you want to absorb everything, you can start on page one and keep going to the end. If you're new to wigs and don't know where to begin, there's an entire section devoted to essential styling techniques that every cosplayer should have in their arsenal. How to cut wigs and the different variations of cutting, working with heating tools, the whole escapade. If you have this knowledge in your toolkit, you'll be able to do a lot of neat things with wigs. And Regan's method of explanation lends itself to providing depth while making it approachable. Now, if you're looking for a specific technique or want to replicate a concept, you can hop to the chapter that you need. The book calls out certain styles that Regan is known for, such as flowers, feathers, and scales. You'll find overviews with text and images to walk the reader through how to reproduce the styles. And using the method of explaining the why something works, the reader is able to apply that information to future wig designs. For example, the section on teasing and volumizing. This is an area that is known by cosplayers, but underutilized. The benefit to teasing is you'll get big, voluminous hair without the need for a lot of wefts or creating a heavy structure to layer the hair on. With the book guiding you through the process, you'll begin to see the endless possibilities of future wig projects. The content in the book feels geared towards those with some styling experience and wanting to take it to the next stage. It covers a number of advanced techniques that most newcomers are not likely to jump straight into for their first time wig styling. But the book does aid beginners with some essential information to help start their first project. As they continue their wig styling journey, they can read further and explore more options. Wigs tend to be intimidating. Once you cut and glue, there's no going back. Overall, this is one of the better cosplay guides I have read. It's detailed, informative, insightful, and most of all, helpful. This is highly recommended for all cosplayers who dabble in any kind of wig work and should be on your wish list. Ah, there you go.
Welcome back, everybody.
Yeah, hope that you guys enjoyed. And again, as a reminder, put that on your wish list, whatever holiday you celebrate, if it's your birthday, if it's thank Miss Ween, I don't care. Put it on your wish list. Everybody needs to get this book.
Yep. You can give it as a Singles Day gift. You can give it as a Chuseok gift. You can give it for Thanksgiving, for Christmas, for Kwanzaa. You know, we have a bunch of holidays coming up. So, I mean, maybe you don't even need an excuse to give it as a gift. Maybe you just want to say thank you to somebody for, you know, being there for you.
There you go.
You know, thanks for being a good friend. Here, have this really awesome book from a really cool cosplayer.
10/10 would read again.
Then again, I kind of encourage people to keep an eye on Humble Bundle anyway, just in general. Yeah. Not only because they offer such book bundles like this, where you can get a ton of really good cosplay material for literally however much you want to pay for it, but it also supports charitable causes when they do this.
Mm-hmm.
you can either donate to the charity that they designate for the bundle, or you can actually enter your own and you can still donate that way. And you choose how much, like how much you give to the authors of the books, how much you give to Humble Bundle themselves for overhead costs, and how much of that goes to the charity as well. So, you know, much love for Humble Bundle. I really, really like them. I've purchased several bundles from them for various things.
Same here, because they also do not just video games. Video games is how they started, but they also do software bundles too. So if you are an artist or a video editor, that's how I have our video editing software. It was, I got it through Humble Bundle. It was so much cheaper than if I had paid the original price, and I made sure to split the money so that way some of it went to charity.
They've also got gaming bundles, mm-hmm. you know, because quarantine, people need stuff to do at home. They also do ebook bundles that are just ebooks, and they're usually themed. So they'll do, like, you can get a whole bunch of, right now, R.A. Salvatore books.
Yeah.
Or you can get a whole bunch of sci-fi books. Or they'll sometimes have manga or comic bundles where you can get a whole bunch of those. Everything's always digital, incidentally. They won't ever send you physical books. But the nice thing is, if you ever lose your copies of those books, you can give them your email address and they will happily send you links to go re-download all of your stuff. So you basically get it for life.
Yeah, it's kind of nice.
I've used that feature once when I lost all of my books.
Oh, ouch.
And I dutifully jotted down all my different order URLs and then I just went, download everything.
Smart. Very smart.
And then I emailed the copies to myself so that I can keep them.
Got to have a backup somehow.
If only I could do that with my sewing pins.
Oh, man.
Keep a backup of my sewing pins so I know where they are at all times.
This is why I have abandoned the squishy tomato and have gotten myself that hard plastic shell so I know where they always are.
The problem was I wasn't even using the squishy tomato for this. My squishy tomato is not for needles. It is only for pins.
That's smart.
The needles, I have a little box because I use the long pearlized pins.
Yes.
Since the little itty bitty short ones aren't great for general use.
They're really
not. I prefer the longer pins. Since they're easier for me to get a grip on and they hold the fabric better since there's more pin to hold the fabric.
Mm-hmm.
So usually what I do is I stick the needle upright in the box of pins because the pins are all laying there. So it's basically the equivalent of sticking them in a tomato without actually having the tomato. And it's a lot more visible to me there because the needle is sticking up and it has colored thread hanging off of it. So that if I ever drop it, I don't look for the needle. I look for the colored thread.
That's what I do.
And also that way I have a handle to pick it up with because some of the needles that I use are really slender
mm-hmm.
and they're hard to pick up. Of course, now I have a stick with uber strong magnets, so that's not a problem. I really hope that it went in the trash.
It might have.
But to that end, I hope that it went in the trash while stuck into a piece of fabric because I also have a heart for the trash people. And if that needle happens to get crushed against something and someone is, you know, pushing or leaning up against it or ends up somehow stabbing themselves on it,
mm-hmm.
I would feel terrible. This is why if ever I have pins break, needles break, or knives break, all three of which I have experienced, none of which were my fault. Incidentally, I hear you guys blaming me already because this is what Amber does. If any of them break, I immediately get a piece of foam and I plunge it into the foam so that there are no sharp pieces and then I duct tape that sucker shut. That way it is completely safe that no one's going to accidentally stab themselves on it when it's in the trash.
You are way too kind because about 99% of everybody else would not do such a thing.
I know.
You're way too nice.
I know how painful it is to stab yourself on those needles.
Well,
I don't
wish
that
all
on
do.
Anybody.
We all do. We all have the marks and the scars and the calluses from it.
Thankfully, I actually don't have any of those from needles.
Oh, I got plenty, especially.
I only have two scars, none of which are actually from sharp things.
Fire?
They're from hot things.
Yeah. Had to be one or the other.
In fact, one of them is from cosplay. I earned myself an electrical burn scar when I had UA.
There you go.
I had, apparently, a wire that was not insulated enough, and it was pressing directly against my skin while it had 8 AA batteries hooked up to it. Oops.
Cosplay. Everybody has a cosplay scar.
Of course, the other one's from my motorcycle. I couldn't help that because I didn't know I was leaning against the hot pipe until my legs started to hurt.
Oh, yeah, you can't really do much about that.
I didn't know. I should have worn... Actually, if I would have worn pants, the fabric would have fused to my skin, so it was actually probably better I was wearing a short.
Right? Oh, man.
Wave Rod, I only wish that I could raise the point because then I could see it and find it.
Ah... Very nice. Very nice. On that note, let's wrap up.
I am on point today. Heyo!
Oh no, here we go. The dad puns are coming. The dad puns are coming.
No, they're not coming. They're going. They're actually going. Of course, if you have any sharp-witted puns you'd like to share with us. If you just want to share your favorite Nick Cage pun, you know, that works too. Feel free to let us have them on any of our social media, which, of course, you can find here.
It's in the corner over there. I'm going to go lie down over there.
It's in the corner in timeout.
It really is.
At least it will be. Or, of course, you can email us, podcast@cospod.org, where we will both read it and both respond to it, though both of us may also be facepalming, depending on what you write.
I'm so glad I don't have chat available, because they're just killing me right now.
I approve.
I figured you would.
All right. So we're going to put a pin in this episode and call an end episode 220 of Cospod the Podcast for all things cosplay. Please stay safe out there. Stay healthy. Wear those masks. Practice good hygiene. Practice good cosplaying technique. We want to see what you guys are working on. Please send it to us. Quarantine is lonely and boring. Anyway, happy cosplaying, everybody. We will see you in episode 221. Bye-bye, everybody.
Bye, guys. I have no point pun.